Hey everyone, thanks for stopping by my channel. Today I'm going to be talking about 11 characters from Pose that are based on real people. Please be sure to click that subscribe button and hit the bell for notifications. Thank you. Pose is a US drama series that premiered on FX in 2018. It follows the up-and-coming house mother Blanca Evangelista as she attempts to make a name for herself in the New York ballroom scene. The series is loosely based on the 1990 documentary Paris is Burning that documents the lives of iconic ballroom pioneers in the late 80s. Most of the characters in the series are based on real members of the ballroom community. They paved the way for LGBTQ+ people of color to flourish in the mainstream media and are the inspiration for many Pose characters. Here's 11 PoseFX characters based on real people. In at number 1 is Live, Work, Pose, Pray Tell, MC, mentor, and ballroom elder. He is mostly inspired by Junior LaBeija. Junior is one of the most captivating cast members in Paris is Burning. Many of Junior's iconic lines from the film are now common catchphrases in mainstream LGBTQ+ culture. His sayings such as, "Why y'all gagging though? Shake the dice and steal the rice," and "It do take nerve," are often said on RuPaul's Drag Race. Junior is a widely respected ballroom historian, and as such feels slighted that the producers of Pose didn't reach out to him for collaboration or to make a cameo on the show. In at number 2, we have none other than our mother, Blanca Evangelista. As the main character of the series, Blanca is a warm, caring, sweet mother who raises her kids with a soft glove, but also a mother's tough love. So who inspired our beautiful Blanca? Angie Xtravaganza and Avis Pendavis are arguably the most clear inspirations for Blanca. Icon Louis Luis Ortiz recently paid tribute to his gay mother Avis Pendavis' memory, and this is what he wrote. She was a champion of wanting her kids to do better for themselves. She wanted us to finish school, get a job, or do something meaningful with our lives. She pushed us to excel more in life than in ballroom. This was important to her, so it became important to us. Sounds just like Blanca to me. Angie Xtravaganza, mother of the House of Xtravaganza, featured in Paris is Burning too. Angie carried on the legacy of the house's founding father, Hector Valley, who was said to be an amazingly elegant Vogue performer. Hector passed away due to AIDS complications in 1985. Angie was a fierce mother who would do anything for her children. In an article by Michael Cunningham, The Slap of Love, he tells the story of Angie beating up a larger man who had called her son Hector Xtravaganza, a homophobic slur. Angie also passed away in 1993 at the age of 28 due to AIDS-related complications. In at number 3 is Angel Evangelista. Blanca's first house member, Angel is a dreamer who is desperate to be loved, devastatingly beautiful, and desires nothing more than to be wanted and validated. Some clear inspirations for Angel are icons Octavia St. Laurent, Tracey Africa Norman, and Carmen Xtravaganza. Octavia St. Laurent, one of the main cast members of Paris is Burning, can be seen sharing her dreams about the future and also attending a modelling competition in the film. Here she is signing up for a modelling competition run by Eileen Ford. Eileen Ford is also the inspiration for Miss Ford on the show. Octavia went on to feature in the major Hollywood picture, The Saint of Fort Washington, alongside Danny Glover and Matt Dillon, and also featured in documentaries How Do I Look and Queen of the Underground. She became an educator, recorded several original songs, and spoke at various AIDS awareness conferences. Octavia sadly passed away due to cancer complications in 2009. In my opinion, Tracey Africa Norman is the clearest inspiration for Angel's story. Tracey is widely known as being the first major transgender model. She appeared in significant campaigns for major brands such as Clairol, Avon, and Balenciaga. She is also the first transgender model to appear in Vogue Italia. However, when Tracy's secret was revealed at a photo shoot for Essence magazine, the pictures were pulled, she was shunned by the industry, and all of her modelling work stopped. Tracy went on to find acceptance in the ballroom community, where she became the mother of the House of Africa. In 2016, Claire reached back out to her, and she became the face of their Nice and Easy Colour As Real As You Are campaign. In the same year, Tracy became one of the first two openly transgender models to appear on the cover of Harper's Bazaar. Lastly for Miss Angel, we have Carmen Xtravaganza. Carmen was not able to find work as a model in the US due to transphobia in the fashion industry. Carmen eventually moved to Spain, where she had a lot of success as a model. Her agency kept her secret for her, and she was able to model for many high-profile clients. Similarly, at the end of Pose Season 2, we see Angel preparing to head off to Europe, where Puppy has secured her some major modelling work. At number 5, we have Damon Evangelista. I know so many of us who have cried our eyes out at the end of Episode 1, where Damon breaks down after auditioning for dance school. Damon is a perfectionist, a master of voguing, and an amazing choreographer. After being kicked out of his home for being gay, he manages to overcome his crippling self-doubt with the help of Mother Blanca. He graduates from dance school and tours around the world, spreading the Evangelista name. The clearest inspiration for Damon would be Willi Ninja. Willi, who founded the House of Ninja with Sandy Apollonia Ninja, was known for his slick perfection and being a master of vogue. He appeared in Malcolm McLaren's music video for his song Deep in Vogue, and then a year later, Madonna released her hit song, Vogue. Willi also danced in Masters at Work's I Can't Sleep, Janet Jackson's All Right, and modeled for Jean-Paul Gaultier and Thierry Mugler. His legacy lives on today, and his house most recently competed in HBO's Legendary. Willi sadly passed away in 2006 of AIDS-related heart failure. At number 6, we have the one and only Elektra Abundance. Elektra's character is larger than life, and she has one of the best story arcs of season 1. One of the clearest inspirations for Elektra is Crystal LaBeija. LaBeija was one of the only few African-American drag queens to be awarded a Queen of the Ball title at a majority white drag ball during this era, and was also crowned Miss Manhattan in 1967. Back then, black drag queens had to whiten their appearance just to stand a chance against their white counterparts. Because of the discrimination in these pageants, Crystal worked with another black drag queen, Lottie LaBeija, to host a ball just for black drag queens and trans women. This event, held in 1972, was the first to be hosted by a house. It was the first time the term house was used, and the rest is history. Crystal also appeared in the 1968 documentary The Queen, which followed drag queens of the time as they competed in a drag pageant. In the film, Crystal calls out discrimination against black drag queens. This is arguably the standout scene of the film.
Monique, darling! Monique was not here as a friend of yours. She's a friend of mine, darling. Monique, would you tell her why you didn't come? Because she knew it's Victor Holler. She said, Crystal, darling, don't go.
That's right, that's
because
right,
you're not right. Going to get it. And that's why all the true beauties didn't
thank
come.
You. It's in bad taste and you're showing your colors and stuff.
I am doing a bad, but I have a right to show my color, darling. I am beautiful and I know I'm beautiful.
Here's a clip of Elektra in episode 1.
You are not on my level. You are jealous and petty and you show your true color.
I have a right to show my colors. And you show yours.
As a fun fact, RuPaul's first experience of a drag performance was seeing Crystal perform a lip sync routine at a nightclub in Atlanta in 1979. Crystal passed away in 1982, but her house is still thriving today. Another inspiration for Miss Elektra Darling is the icon Dorian Corey. Dorian is most notably seen in Paris is Burning, defining the difference between reading and throwing shade.
Shade comes from reading. Reading came first. Reading is the real art form of insult. Then when you are all of the same thing, then you have to go to the fine point. In other words, if I'm a black queen and you're a black queen, we can't call each other black queens because we're both black queens. That's not a read, that's just a fact. So then we talk about your ridiculous shape, your saggy face, your tacky clothes. Then reading became a developed form where it became shade. Shade is, I don't tell you you're ugly, but I don't have to tell you because you know you're ugly. And that's shade.
Shade and reading have made their way into pop culture and mainstream LGBTQ+ culture too. It's really important to know the roots of black queer vernacular and culture so that we can avoid cultural appropriation. After Dorian's death, a mummified body with a bullet in its head was found in her wardrobe. It is thought to have been a client of hers or a boyfriend who became violent. The body was later identified as Robert Willi, who had been arrested for raping a woman in 1963. In season 2, Elektra has a very similar plotline, which touches on the abuse that trans women, particularly of colour, suffer at the hands of the police. Dorian died of AIDS complications in August 1993, but her legacy lives on today, and there is an annual ball held in her name in Philadelphia. In at number 7, we have Candy Abundance, Later Ferocity. Candy is like the Crystal LaBeija of the series. She doesn't hold her tongue and she makes sure that she's seen and heard. Candy holds up a mirror to dark-skinned queer people who often feel invisible and invalidated in our own communities. Candy refuses to be sidelined, and it is for this reason that she is so inspirational. When Candy and Lulu leave the House of Abundance to form the House of Ferocity, Candy takes on sex work at a dangerous motel where she is eventually killed. The clear inspiration for Candy's story is Venus Xtravaganza. Venus featured in Paris is Burning, where she spoke of her dreams of having a family in the suburbs and becoming a supermodel. She also detailed the abuse that she faced as a trans sex worker.
I used to hustle in New York to make my money. I was with a guy and he was playing with my titties till he touched me down there. He felt it and he seen it and he like totally flipped out. He said, "You f***ing it. You're a freak. You're a victim of AIDS and you're trying to give me AIDS. What are you, crazy? You're a homo. I should kill you." You know, stuff like that. And like, I was really terrified, so I just jumped out the window. I grabbed my bag and just jumped out the window.
Venus's dreams were cut short as she was murdered during the filming of the documentary. On Christmas Day in 1988, she was found strangled under a bed at the Duchess Hotel in New York. Till this day, no one has been charged with her murder. Violence still persists against trans women today. In 2020, 44 trans and non-gender conforming people were murdered in the United States, over 76% of whom were black. So far, 2 black trans women have already been killed this year. I'll put links to black trans charities you can donate to and support in the description box below. We need to end violence against the trans community immediately. I also wanted to quickly note that many fans of the show were really disappointed with Candy's storyline. In particular, they noted that her storyline reeked of colorism. In Courtney Anderson's article for Medium, Pose has an increasingly obvious colorism problem. Courtney writes, "Since the show started, there's really only been 2 dark-skinned trans women characters with prominent roles, Elektra and Candy. And while I have been living for them both, it's clear the writers have intentionally portrayed them both as aggressive, violent, vindictive, and messy in a way that their lighter-skinned counterparts aren't." I had never even noticed this until after reading this article, and I was really hurt that this is how the writers and producers of Pose saw dark-skinned queer people. We see dark-skinned characters in Pose as narcissists, violent, cheaters, players, and loud, whereas the light-skinned characters are portrayed as sweet, beautiful, caring, and love interests. I do want to give another perspective though. I feel there are various moments where we see Candy and Elektra's vulnerability. For example, when Candy is rejected at the balls for having a masculine body type and confides in Angel. Also the moments where Elektra confides in Candy and Aphrodite about her struggles with not having had her gender reassignment surgery. We also have to note that Elektra is portrayed as the epitome of beauty throughout the series. And even more impressive was the love story between Ricky and Pray Tell, two dark-skinned gay men making passionate love to each other on a major TV show. That was incredible. With all that said, it still does not negate or excuse the common thread of colorism in the show's writing and casting. At number 8, 9, and 10, we have Lil Papi and Quincy and Chili. These three characters are thought to be inspired by the two kids from Paris is Burning. I recently made a video about those two little cuties. Check out my video on them if you can. The boy in blue is still alive and well today, but no one has heard from the boy in white since filming Paris is Burning. Lil Papi in particular is thought to be inspired by the boy in white. And last but not least, at number 11 is Frederica Norman. Frederica is Blanca's arch nemesis in the series. She's a property tycoon who takes pride in being mean, rich, and money savvy. Frederica is loosely based on Leona Helmsley, a flamboyant and sometimes tyrannical American businesswoman who earned the nickname Queen of Mean. Helmsley was convicted of tax evasion in 1989, and during her trial, it was claimed that she once said, "We don't pay taxes, only the little people pay taxes." The plotline of Frederica's house being covered in a giant condom was also based on a real event too. In September 1991, Peter Staley and other early ACT UP activists wrapped the house of Senator Jesse Helms in a massive condom. The group was protesting the stance Helms had taken on several AIDS-related issues. Thanks so much for watching. Please subscribe and leave a comment below. I've also got some Pose-inspired merch on my website. Check out the link in the description box to check that out. Hey everyone, hope you enjoyed the video. Just wanted to give you an extra bonus facts for my ballroom history lovers. Remember when Elektra performed as Mary Antoinette and Pray Tell read her for filth? Well, this moment was also inspired by Dorian Corey. In his article for the Wall Street Journal, Joseph Cassara writes that when Angie Xtravaganza was a young teen, she had read about Dorian Corey in the paper. She rushed down to one of Dorian's performances where she was in awe of Dorian's performance as Mary Antoinette. Angie later recreated this moment with the House of Xtravaganza. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Oh, and hit that bell button too. Bye.